Hi, and welcome back in the lectures about gaming simulation. Today I would like to show you some examples of the four uses of gaming. And at last I would like to say something about the current hype word, gamification. If you look into the four uses of gaming, you could say that there's intervention, where group learning, policy intervention, and the theory by Dick Duke and Gertz on the five C's of gaming is important. Then we have teaching, actually learning some types of complexity, experiential learning, learning of dangerous tasks. And we have gaming as an empirical test environment to test designs, hypotheses, as a behavioral lab. And last but certainly not least, gaming for design in interactive environments, the use of visualization, and as a platform function in design. Now let's go into an example about intervention. We did some work for the police forces. The police force tries to change into intelligence-based policing, which means that the police force will become proactive instead of reactive, depending on the information that they have about, for instance, patterns in crime. If you're fond of American crime movies, then this is something that you've absolutely seen on all those screens. But how do you change this organization? This was a process with many hurdles, and in 2011 this got halted, and then we were asked to make a game for all the vice commanders of police in the Netherlands to play the future organization in which intelligence-based policing was implemented, and then to go back and see, like, okay, what do we still need to do to get there, and do we actually want this? For teaching, I have an example from an oil company where we build a game that trains participants to recognize dangerous tasks. And it's called the hazard recognition game. And in this example, for instance, you see that there are tasks going on about lifting and hoisting of a particular safety valve from a top. So it's a 3D game built here in-house where we mimic an existing oil drilling site. We actually took photos and drawings of that site. This is a typical gas well. And there at the back you see that there's a crane and a crew that has to do a particular task. This task has to be done in a safe way, and therefore you need to interact with all the people in the game to make sure that they do their task in the correct way. Otherwise, catastrophe will happen and everything will blow up. That's the good thing about these types of training games. It can be a catastrophe, but then you just press replay and there you start again. The third use is games as an empirical test environment. Can we, for instance, test hypotheses? Can we test our ideas about designs and how they will behave with the people in the loop? Here I have an example from Sweden where what we did was testing what will happen if we, for instance, ask people in the road sector, constructors, road authorities, etc., to come up with all kinds of really innovative designs for new roads. What you see here is all kinds of people and, from different backgrounds. It was in collaboration with KTH, Swedish University, where the road administration, and these are people that really have this role, they set the criteria in the game for what they actually want. They want a particular capacity, they want some innovative things for public transport. Of course, the road should not fall apart, so it needs to be robust, very environmentally friendly, and last not least, there needs to be redevelopment of a support area. All this together led to a very interactive process between contractors and their suppliers, in which the contractors were doing all kinds of bits. We played this game during the day in which there were also seminars, and what you see here is that people actually engage so much in their roles because they're real contractors, that even at a very classy dinner at a castle, they're really putting in their roles and putting their bits and trying to win the game. They were very fanatic. This led to some new hypothesis about how the dynamics between the different actors in this industry actually work. Last example is about gaming for design. This is a fairly new area. We don't see it that often. There's a framework that I would like to introduce here, which is called the PSI framework by Professor Subramanian, Joram Reich, and myself, that distinguishes what we call the product space, all the things that have to do with the definition of the actual product that gives a solution to a problem. The social space, which involves the people that use it, the knowledge, the community around a particular problem and product, and the institutional space, the rules that these organizations have, procurement structures, etc. The thing is that if you want to do design of these complex systems, that you really need to connect this P, S, and I space together in the design. And that's very hard. Because each of these spaces has different dimensions, different traditions in the way they use particular methods. And here we use games as a way to go back and forth between the different spaces. Here we draw those spaces with three dimensions, but depending on the type of problem, it may have n dimensions. But to characterize a problem in these different domains will bind together, let's say, the engineers that work in the P space, managers that work in the S space, and the politicians that work in the I space, if you go back to the first lecture that we had. Now, let me give you an example again from ProRail. As said earlier, this is the Dutch Railway Infrastructure Manager. And what we try to do here, what you see in this game, in this movie, is that we test out scenarios, not about disruptions, but about a new particular design, the design of traffic control on the largest central station in the Netherlands, the real central node in the network, which is the Utrecht Central Station. Here again, we use fairly simple tools, but real people, real experts, you might recognize a few faces from the movie that I showed in the previous lecture, real people as experts trying to simulate the effects of new designs. Here, what we could do is after each particular round, we evaluated what would happen and where the design was actually interesting to test. So together with the people that know how it works in reality, we designed the test and we came up with better solutions. So what was tested then find out? A change in the P space, more trains, obviously, leads to changes in the S space. It leads to new arrangements between the people that needs to be involved in solving the disruption. And to do so, we need actually to change the rules of the organization, access to knowledge, and for instance, the public-private balance of this particular good. And here, we really prove that gaming is a way to go back and forth between changes in these different spaces. Now, as a concluder, you might have heard about the word gamification. It's really popular at the moment, as was the word serious games about 5, sometimes 8 years ago. What does gamification actually mean? We try to influence the behavior of people in a positive way by making systems change into a game. That may sound very difficult, but actually it's quite old. It's not simulation, but it's really using game elements to do something in the real world. One example, a Swedish example again, was that the police were photographing the license plates of cars that actually kept below a particular maximum speed. And there would be a lottery amongst all the car drivers that actually well behaved. And this led to a remarkable improvement of the compliance to the maximum speed on that particular road. There are also many competitions within companies on particular critical performance indicators, key performance indicators. So for instance, different teams may win a particular week if they did very well. Now, if you take this a few steps further, you can make many things into a game. And now in the era of social media, you see that platforms like Facebook, like MySpace and some other platforms are actually trying to make their platform the key place for these gamification things to happen. Thank you for your attention for today. If you have any questions, feel welcome to post them again on the discussion forum, and we'll try to answer them as good as possible. Thank you.